So when integrating IoT solutions, that's not really easy. There's like lots of technologies going on. You need to understand your domain. You need to understand the cloud and so forth. That's where you need to have support from an integrator like Amis, specialized in smart grid solutions. Tomasz and Robbrecht are here to share, you know, their insights, their learnings, the pitfalls of integrating IoT solution and how they do that in their company. That's today on the IoT Show. Hi, everyone. This is the IoT Show. I'm Olivier, your host. Today, we'll talk about a return on experience building smart grid solutions, some tips and tricks from experts. And for that, we have Tomasz and Robbrecht from Amis, who are a partner of Microsoft. And Tomasz, Robbrecht, thanks for joining the show today. Let's do some introductions to get started. Robbrecht, what about you? Who are you? What are you doing in life?
I'm working as the head of IoT with Amis Conclusion, and we're working on scaling up IoT solutions for energy manufacturing companies in the Netherlands using Microsoft technology, and especially last time in the energy and smart grid solutions.
Nice. How about you, Tomasz? Little introduction about yourself.
Hello, I'm Tomasz Brzezinski. I'm a principal solution architect at Amis Conclusion. I'm the IoT solution architect of the platform that we are going to talk about today.
Nice. And I very much appreciate your time. As you were saying, you're calling from the Netherlands. So it's very much like time difference here. So I think it's late in the evening for you. So we appreciate your time here. And also your presence, because it's super important to discuss, you know, the importance of integration in IoT. IoT solutions are becoming bigger and bigger. They are also complex to integrate, and having experts like yourselves help our customers, our joint customers, getting to produce nice solutions that will help their own customers. So what's specific about smart grid solutions, like compared to IoT solutions in general, right? Are there several things you can share with us that make smart grid solutions particular and your expertise in that domain even more required from our customers?
Yeah, I can elaborate a little bit about this. Compared to regular smart grid solutions, regular IoT solutions, smart grid, it's very large in scale. That's the first difference. The other one, and it's in scale number of devices, but also the frequency of the messages which are being sent around. I think that the second one is the complexity in messaging back and forward. So in first, you need to measure the state of the smart grid. And if you come to the conclusion that something is wrong or you have to adjust something, then you have to send messages back to adjust the settings in this network or to adjust settings in physical equipment. So, and because it's physical equipment, security is also very important, but that's more generic in for every IoT solution.
Yeah. And when you're talking about scaling, it's not just about the number of devices, it's also about the variety of the devices, very different types of devices from different manufacturers, installed and deployed by different vendors or different contractors, I guess, right?
Yeah, that's correct. And then for this, and a couple of years ago, we just saw specific siloed solution for a specific type of meter or a specific type of valve or a specific type of electrical engine. And now companies are more and more trying to integrate this into a whole grid solution. That means that you have to process data from very small, quite simple smart meters, all the way down to very complex and big complete energy systems, for example, and connect them to each other and also integrate them into the backend systems, which are also, in this case, enterprise grade. So it's kind of like we are the plumbers of data processing in this area. We take data from a very specific place, get it to a central place where decisions are being made from enterprise systems or for analytics purposes, and send data back to a very fine-grained network, which is already in place.
Nice. Just to give us an idea, here we're talking about actual real smart grid solution deployed. We'll not say the name of the customer, but how many devices, how many, you know, endpoints are we talking about here?
Yeah. Initially, these companies started, they already had a smart grid because every energy company needs some information about measurements, how much energy or power is being used. That initially started with 300 devices as a minimal viable product, but we got involved in this project just to scale this up to a larger number and also to a larger number of types of products. And at the moment, we are at about 15,000 connected devices, and it's still growing with about 100 devices a day. And it's scaled for a couple of hundreds of thousands of devices. And also the frequency of the measurements for, in general, you could expect that when you talk about energy meter for billing, that will be sufficient to measure once a day or once a week. In this case, we're measuring every 50 minutes, and it's being ramped up to, at the moment, almost, for some devices, almost every 2 minutes.
Wow. Yeah, that's, interestingly, for people who are not familiar with IoT scenarios, they might be like, whoa, why don't I have real-time data coming up? But yeah, when you talk about scale and number of devices, then once every 2 minutes is actually a lot, because if it's coming from all those devices, that's something that you have to have a backend that can support that. We like to think that Azure IoT is a set of services that allows scaling, you know, flexibly. And I would like for you guys eventually, Tomasz, to tell me a bit more about the architecture and how you're using the various services that we're offering, and maybe point to the places where the scaling is made easier in terms of implementation on your side, thanks to these services.
Yeah, actually, this solution is, it gave us opportunity to use various products and various services offered by Azure Microsoft. If we could show the slide, there is an example of some of the services that we are using. We are using IoT Edge. We are using IoT Hub with device provisioning system. We are using Event Grid to trigger several different types of functions. We are using Stream Analytics, Cosmos DB, all the services that you could see. And probably you could recognize some of the patterns that are advised by Microsoft. That's another thing which helps us a lot. Quite good documentation and good reusable patterns that we can compose in quite complex solutions.
Nice. And you just mentioned that, like, when you start with IoT solution development and implementation, it's not always easy to identify what's the right setup, what's the right configuration, what's the right architecture here. And so we have these guidances, these reference design or architecture that we provide, but I personally think that having the expertise of someone like you guys who've been through for a specific area or domain, implemented your own architecture on top of the recommended suggested ones is definitely the way to go, because it's not simple. But actually, if you could share with us some of your insights, you know, as you've been working with these services for a long time, as you're an expert as a company and as individuals, you're experts in the domain of smart grid in particular. But what are the things that you would say are the best practices, the key learnings, the pitfalls that you identified while you were working at aggregating these services in the cloud, and that you can share so that everyone actually knows what they're going to be facing when they start aggregating solutions?
Yeah, that's scalability of the solution is probably the main thing. We have started, as Robrecht mentioned, preparing proof of concept that was already designed to be scalable. However, with the growing amount of different sort of devices, different types of devices producing data with different frequency, we found out that some of the solutions that we adopted were not suitable for it. For example, when we created the solution, we used Influx's database for time series. And then throughout the project, we discovered that there is a new service from Microsoft, Azure Data Explorer, which simply perfectly fit our purpose. And then we adopted that service instead of Influx. That's one of the examples.
Nice. So it's basically trying to keep up with the rhythm at which Microsoft is releasing products. Not saying that you should always switch to the latest or greatest or whatever we release at Microsoft, but as you were saying, you identify that as better fit for your architecture and for that solution, and we're able to adopt that. I think it's actually another argument for our customers to go to integrators and partners like Amis, because that way they don't have to keep track of all of that or try and keep the pace. You are experts, you see them coming, you evaluate them, these new services and features, and then you can propose your customers to deploy that in their own solutions, right?
Yeah, that's correct. And then sometimes keeping up with changes and new services offered by Microsoft Azure is quite complex for someone who is not really deeply technical. And then another example is during our project, Microsoft also released the Kafka extension for Azure Functions. That's mm-hmm. another thing that greatly facilitated our integration work. If you could go again to the slide, please, then you could see we are using Kafka to integrate with external systems of our customer. And then we process quite a lot of data in both ways. So we subscribe to topics to consume the data, but we also publish some data that is consumed by external systems. And that's, you could say, a central part of connecting with all other systems. And therefore, the extension for Azure Functions greatly help us to simplify the solution.
Nice.
And I think just to elaborate a little bit more about this concept and this architecture, when we started, some of the business cases were already very clear, but there were a lot of business cases which were still in development. So we needed a kind of platform where it was very easy to add a lot of new functionality without all the groundwork of setting up databases or setting up application services or integration components. So this made it possible to be very flexible in the functionality and in the logic and the integrations we were creating without completely refactoring the architecture from scratch when something new was happening. For example, in the beginning, the requirement was to send out every half an hour, every 15 minutes a message, and now we're talking about every 2 minutes. Probably can happen that in the near future they would like to have a message and also a message back within a couple of seconds. This architecture is prepared for this. It will probably use some different components and some different logic, but you can change it while you're working on it. You don't have to redo a lot of things again. And also the openness of the architecture makes it possible that this isn't completely open architecture. In the back end, some of the logic is not in Azure technology. It's in different systems because they're specialized in optimizing the energy grid, talking to other systems, to energy providers, to consumers. They're not included in Azure, but we can communicate with these in a very secure and open way.
I see. So there's actually two main ideas here that you shared. One is being trying to reduce, I would say, the amount of custom code by using existing components, existing services, right? And the second one is the capability of integrating with third party or with other solutions in one place, and that is secure in terms of establishing communications as well as communicating and data transfers and. Right. And hosting one, right?
Yeah, that's right. And then also, as Robrecht mentioned, modularity of the solution help us to either substitute a certain service or upgrade it or add additional functionality or additional services without disturbing the entire platform and without disturbing the existing data flows.
I like the way you, Robrecht, discussed about the fact that you're kind of the plumbers for smart grid solutions. And I do like that because I do like to say myself that Azure IoT or IoT in general as a technology is plumbing. And so as plumber, it's natural to use the services or package, right? And you just aggregate them into a solution and you adapt that solution based on your understanding of how the flow of data needs to go, the requirements in terms of scaling, in terms of security, and so on. So I like this idea. We're the plumbing, you're the plumbers. That works pretty well for our customers, our joint customers. At the end of the day, aggregating IoT or putting together IoT solutions is not easy. It's not simple. Lots mm-hmm. of moving parts. As you were saying, technology is evolving super fast. And so being able to count on skilled people who know, you know, their part and understand how to integrate them into a broader solution or application, I think is key, right? Isn't that one of the learnings on your side?
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right about having skilled people, of course, but also to have have the knowledge to look a little bit ahead what's happening next, because you can build something which is working right now, but it also has to work in a couple of years or in 10 years. These systems are working with things which are connected in the real world, and when something locally isn't working and you have to visit it to update the driver or to update connectivity, it's far too costly when you talk about 10,000 of devices. So you have to think up front about creating something which is quite stable in the edges, but also very flexible internally to adjust it for functionality, to adjust it for new features, and to adjust it for connecting to different systems in the backend.
Nice. Well, Tomasz, Robbrecht, I think that's a good insight. Thanks for sharing your learnings, the best practices in creating IoT solutions in the context of your smart energy grid, which is really, really nice. We have a link we're going to bring up down there, aka.ms/IoTShow/AMIS, which is the name of your company. If people want to reach out, do they just like reach out, finding contact info on AMIS, or how does it work?
Yeah, when you go to this link, you can find my contact information or Thomas' contact information. Feel free to drop us an email when you want to know more about the solution, when you want to know more about the technology or the business benefits, or when you want to enjoy working with our colleagues. Everything is possible with us.
Great. Okay. Well, thanks for your presence today and for sharing all these insights. I'm sure people will appreciate and realize that they can work with integrators like AMIS to get their solutions out there. Well, thanks a lot for your time. And thanks everyone for joining us today on the IoT Show. See you soon. Bye-bye.